Do black people have weaker lungs than white people? I get it. You're confused as to why I'm asking you such a silly question. Medicine would never perpetuate a racist myth about black bodies with no biological basis whatsoever, right? Right? So there actually is a notion that black people have a lower lung capacity than white people. So much so that this notion is actually built into the technology that is used to measure our lungs. How did this idea, that was conjured up in the 1700s in the US during times of slavery, make its way into the modern day? And how does this affect us all? But before you get into that, make sure that you like and subscribe to the channel. Where did the idea that black people have a lower lung capacity come from? For us to figure that out, we need to go back. It's 1785. The president of the US is Thomas Jefferson, and he describes a difference in pulmonary apparatus between black enslaved people and white people. And this essentially is the basis of the belief that black people have weaker lungs. During this time, this was sort of an agreed notion, despite the fact that there wasn't really much data or statistics behind it. But that would all change. This is a spirometer, or at least this was an early version of the spirometer. The ones that we use nowadays look a lot different, but technology has to start somewhere, right? You take a deep breath and blow into the machine as much as you can, and it measures the amount of air that comes out. And from here, this is how we measure lung capacity. The person who invented it was a man named John Hutchinson. He was from England, and he realized that with this invention, he could measure how healthy police officers were or the armed forces, he could use it for insurance claims, and he could also use it to diagnose TB, which at the time was pretty bad. He quickly realized that there is a correlation between height and lung capacity. What he also started to do was classify people based on their occupation. So where did this idea about race come into things? For us to understand that, we need to take a trip to the US. So the spirometer started gaining popularity and notoriety, and physicians from other countries started developing it, improving it, and using it in different parts of the world. And one of those places was the US, and one of those people was a man named Samuel Cartwright. He was a plantation owner and a physician. He wanted to build upon Thomas Jefferson's idea that black people had a deficiency in their pulmonary apparatus. So he decided that he could use the spirometer to prove this point. What he apparently concluded was that black people had a decreased lung capacity of about 20% when it was compared to white people. Now this is major because this was the first time that testing was now attributed to this false notion of black lungs. The issue here is that it completely ignores any other factor that has an impact on lung capacity, like for example, the conditions that the enslaved people were living in, their diet, how they were treated, the environment. But also look at the context here. Samuel Cartwright was a plantation owner as well as a physician, so it would have been in his interest to use science to try and back up the reason as to why black people should be enslaved. And it's frustrating because what we're seeing here is a medical tool that revolutionized the way that we see lungs being used to back up racist ideology. But it didn't stop there. This is Benjamin Gold. He did a large study 1 year before the end of the Civil War, and he used the spirometer to measure the lung capacities of Union soldiers. Now, these soldiers were black, white, and also mixed. He concluded that the white soldiers had higher lung capacities than the black soldiers and the mixed soldiers, once again ignoring most other factors that contribute to lung capacity and solely focusing on race. Now, this study was done hundreds of years ago, but would you be surprised if I told you that it continued to get cited in modern papers up until the 2000s? And it's because of studies like these that continue to get cited. That's essentially how this idea, although it's not founded on any fact, made its way into modern medicine, unchallenged. So what's the impact of modern medicine carrying this myth about black lungs? Well, to start with, spirometers started to have race adjustments. Would you be surprised if I told you that those race adjustments still persist in the technology that measures our lungs? Even today, when a black person breathes into a spirometer, what's considered normal for them is about 10 to 15% less than the normal considered for a white person. And if it's an Asian person, this is about 4 to 6% less than a white person. This video would not be possible without the research of a professor called Lundi Braun. She's a professor of Africana Studies and Medical Science at Brown University, and she's been documenting the history of the spirometer for years. She interviewed a lot of the operators of the spirometer, and many of them were completely unaware that they were even making these race adjustments. It's built into the machinery. But back to the impact. Because what is considered normal for a black person is less than what's normal for a white person, it means that a black person is less likely to be diagnosed with certain conditions. This means that you're also less likely to be higher up on a lung transplant list, for example. Therefore, this all leads to poorer health outcomes that contributes to structural racism that we see in medicine today. The American Thoracic Society even found that when you remove race adjustments from the results, black people have more prevalent and more severe lung conditions. So really and truly, this myth that found its way into the modern day of medicine, that found its way into modern technology, could be the difference between life and death of a black person, could be the difference between them getting a lung transplant or not. Now, can we even begin to think about how this can impact insurance claims, disability benefits, or COVID-19 assistance when it comes to recovery? I should say that this wasn't without criticism. We had notable people like W.E.B. Du Bois and Kelly Miller that were firm opponents of this idea of black lungs, but their voices were unheard because racism. There have also been more papers from the American Thoracic Society that say that we need to move away from race adjustments when it comes to lung testing, because it is causing health inequality. Look, medicine has a history, like many things, and some of that history is steeped in colonialism, in racism, sexism, and homophobia. And we need to acknowledge this past and reflect on how it impacts our present, because if we don't do that, we're going to continue seeing health gaps in between marginalized groups. The idea that race correction or race adjustment is still used in modern lung function tests is interesting because it has no biological backing, and we often see medicine as purely empirical and purely factual. But if there's an idea that is still perpetuated in medicine with no biological backing, no scientific backing, then there needs to be a reflection on why that is still there and why we're continuing to operate with this thing. Medicine shouldn't be seen as this thing that exists on its own in this completely factual cloud. It has a history and it can't be divorced from it. We need to reflect on that so we can understand it better and understand how to close these gaps in healthcare. Hello, I'm Jamisha from You Look Okay To Me, and I'll be making video essays about this type of stuff, about healthcare and its history and its present and all sorts of cool stuff like that. So be sure to like, comment and subscribe so you don't miss an upload. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.